I myself, why Ratni Singh? I myself, why Ratna Sindhu? I myself, why Ratna Sindhu, Assistant Professor, Department of Pharmaceutical Regulatory Affairs, Hindu College of Pharmacy. A very good afternoon to one and all. On behalf of Hindu College of Pharmacy, we, the Department of Pharmaceutical Regulatory Affairs, welcomes you for this fabulous online program, PRAJWALA, an international webinar series on contemporary issues in pharmaceutical regulatory affairs. Ours is one of such institutions, Hindu College of Pharmacy, started in 1999 and educating students to face the real world in all the possible ways since 20 years. Our esteemed institute stands for its excellence, and there are many people to mention for their marvelous service to uphold the policy of educating and benefiting students with knowledge in Hindu College of Pharmacy. They are none other than our management, Sri Jupudi Rangaraj Garu, Chairman, and Dr. S. Madhusudan Rao Garu, Secretary and Correspondent, and our Principal, Dr. R. Govindarajan Garu, Vice Principal, Dr. A. Sunita Garu, and OSD, Director of PharmD, P. Sitaramaya Garu. I am glad to introduce them to you all. We are also proud to say our Department of Pharmaceutical Regulatory Affairs, led by dynamic head Dr. M. V. Nagabhushtam Garu, under his leadership, this department had developed like an education hub. And we are proud to say it is one of the best departments in Hindu College of Pharmacy. Now it's time to welcome our speaker for today's session, A.Srinath Garu, Research Scientist, Leutis Pharmaceuticals, Private Limited, Hyderabad. Sir is skilled at analytical method validation, characterization of impurities, design of specifications, and tech transfers. Sir will deliver his talk on today's topic, analytical method validation and its regulatory significance as per ICH and USP. Finally, it is more important to welcome you all once again with deep gratitude for your fantabulous responses for the program organizing by Department of Pharmaceutical Regulatory Affairs, Hindu College of Pharmacy. We'll start the program with the Vande Mataram. Now I request our HOD, convener of today's program, Dr. M.V. Nagabhushtam Garu, to start this session with the opening remarks. Over to our respected HOD, sir.
Good afternoon to all esteemed participants present to this third day of international webinar series, PRAJWALA, organized by Department of Pharmaceutical Regulatory Affairs, Hindu College of Pharmacy, Guntur, Andhra Pradesh, India. From 24th June onwards, we are conducting a series of international webinars for the benefit of pharmacy students and also the fraternity of pharma professionals present all over the world. To make these unexpected days of the pandemic that is prevailing because of COVID-19, the management of Hindu College of Pharmacy has taken this decision to conduct a series of webinars for the benefit of students and professionals of pharma fraternity. I myself, Professor M.V. Nagabhushtam, head of the Department of Pharmaceutical Regulatory Affairs, extend you all a heartiest welcome and a humanitarian, a generous philanthropist, and a renowned advocate of Guntur City, and a able administrator, successful leader, and moreover, our beloved chairman, Sri Jupudi Rangaraj Garu, to this webinar series. And to this international webinar series, we cordially welcome our physician, visionary, insightful, and inspiring personality, Dr. S. Madhusudan Rao Garu, Secretary and Correspondent of Hindu College of Pharmacy. I extend my ardent welcome to our principal, Dr. R. Govindarajan Garu, Vice Principal Sunita Madam, Farmdi Director and OSD Sitaramay Garu to this webinar series. I heartfully welcome today's speaker, A.Srinath, Research Scientist, Senior Principal Research Scientist from Leutis Pharmaceuticals Private Limited, Hyderabad, who has given us acceptance upon our request and accepting our invitation to spare his time and to share his knowledge to enlighten all of us on this topic of analytical method validation and significance of regulatory bodies as per ICH and USP guidelines. Because the pharmaceutical regulatory affairs has its significant role to play at every stage of pharmaceutical production, pharmaceutical analytical method development, etc., in accordance with the regulatory guidelines given by ICH, CDSCO, USFDA, EMA, etc. Today, we are going to discuss about the analytical method validation and its regulatory significance as per the international regulatory bodies such as ICH and FDA. A fraternal welcome to all my fellow faculty members who are playing a significant role in this growth of Temple of Learning, and also a warm welcome to all dearest students from across the country and from many other countries who are seeking an important knowledge on this particular regulatory affairs topic. I extend my hearty welcome to all the participants, and also once again, the August gathering, and welcome to this webinar. I request our department senior faculty member, Nagarjun Reddy Garu, to introduce our today's speaker, A.Srinath Garu. Over to Nagarjun Reddy.
Thank you, sir. Yeah, it's my pleasure to Srinath Garu, to introduce you on behalf of Hindu College of Pharmacy Management, Principal Sir and Vice Principal Sir and Department of Regulatory Affairs. I will now introduce about Srinath Garu. The educational qualification, he has done his M.Pharm, UG and PG, B.Pharmacy in Nizam Institute of Pharmacy and M.Pharm in Trinity College of Pharmaceutical Sciences. Sir has professional experience of 7 years and is currently working in Leutis Pharma as research scientist in analytical department. Sir is versed in the areas of method validation, characterization of impurities, design of specification, and tech transfers. Leutis Pharma is a closely held, professionally managed pharmaceutical research and development driven company, having wide range of expertise from different facets of pharmaceutical research, intellectual property, alliance, and medical practice. Sir has done different preparations of technical documents and reports for regulatory submissions and FDA queries. He has support and coordinate for completion of IQ, OQ, PQ, that is nothing but installation qualification, operation qualification, and performance qualifications for new instruments to ensure GLP and safety compliances in the labs. Sir has knowledge of ICH GLP guidelines in submission of US and European markets and in development of SOPs, protocols of analytical method developments, and plan and executive project involving method development and validation as per regulatory requirements. Sir, it's my pleasure to introduce about yourself and our views. Thank you.
I request Srinath Garu to start his session.
Good afternoon to everyone. I thank the management of Hindu College of Pharmacy and professors for giving me this opportunity to participate in PRAJWALA and share my knowledge on analytical method validation and significance in regulatory bodies. Now we'll start with Now we'll start with our session about the analytical method validation and its significance as per ICH and USP. Hello. Yeah, we'll start with
our... Once close the share and reopen it, sir.
So close this, open. Share open is it, close it. How it like, is it okay, sir?
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. Please disable annotation, sir.
It is okay.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah. Today we will start our session, analytical method validation and its significance as per USP and ICH. First of all, we'll see and myself, A.Srinath. My education qualification is Master's in Pharmaceutical Analysis and I have 7 years of experience in Leutis Pharmaceuticals. My main work area is that analytical method development and validations, characterization of impurities, design of specifications and tech transfers, and for liquid injections, lyophilized products, suspensions, emulsions, and oral dosage forms. Before going into the validation, we'll see the basics first of all, and what are the different guidances which support the validations, method validations. So according to the, there are different guidances for method validations. First is according to USFDA. According to the USFDA, method validation is nothing but collection and evaluation of data from the process design stage through commercial production, which establishes scientific evidence that a process is capable of consistently delivering a quality products. According to ICH guidelines, method validation is nothing but action of proving in accordance with principles of GMP that any procedures, process, equipment, material activity or system actually leads to expected results. And according to USP, validation of analytical method is a process that establishes by laboratory studies that the performance characteristics of method meets the requirements for the intended analytical applications. If you see the different guidelines, the validation is nothing but to proving the method is capable for whatever we are using for the purpose, intended purpose. The validation guidelines provides you how the method validation can be done. It does not provide any, excuse me, it does not recommend, it only recommends the how the method validations can be done using the different guidances. The method validations for different products and characteristics will depend upon their individual characterizations. Why the method validation is necessary? Method validations establishes the fitness for purpose. Nothing but the validations, whatever you are performing, they are for the giving the validations, whatever you are doing, it gives the quality of the product for the analytical methods. Analytical methods like identification, related substances, assay, they give the description about the quality of the product, which enables the guidances, nothing but US FDA, other drug administrative departments to ensure the quality of the product. Validation is an essential part of the GMP practice. Identification of sources and quantification of the potential errors.
Nothing but validation gives us what are the potential errors they are present while executing an analytical method. Determination if the method is acceptable for the intended use. See, different analytical methods we'll be using for the different purposes, nothing but identification or any purity or potency establishment. So for this purpose, the validation gives us what type, up to what extent the method can be used. And the method validation establishes a proof that method can be used for the decision making, nothing but to decide whether the product has a good quality and ensures the safety of the product. So what are the different guidances there for the method validations? Guidance documents for validations are validations of analytical processes Q2R1, that is nothing but from ICH 2005. Guidance for the industry, analytical processes and methods validation for drugs and biologicals by FDA in 2015. And according to the USP, the validation of compendial processes 1-2-5 and verification of compendial processes 1-2-6. There is a lot of confusion between the validation, method validation, method transfer, revalidation, and verification. They are all different, but they are connected to each other. Method validation, nothing but you are going to validate all the parameters according to the different guidances and establish the documented evidence about the analytical method. Revalidation is nothing but you are going to, if you are changing any method, analytical method, or any change in the composition of the formulation, you will be revalidating the method with minimum parameters. Method verification is nothing but, according to the USP, there are compendial methods and non-compendial methods. When you are using the compendial methods, nothing but which are published in the USP, you will be having only the verification process where you will go for the only minimal parameters for verification of the method. And method transfer is nothing but you are going to transfer the method to the analytical lab, different lab, where in one site you have completely validated the method and with minimum parameters you are going to transfer the analytical method so that the testing of the drug products can be done. So when is the analytical method validation is required? Analytical method validation is required for the ongoing and routine testing of in quality control and when there are changes in the previous validation conditions. Nothing but if you are going to change any analytical method parameters, there are any formulation related matrices, then you are going to go for the method validation. And method validation is a part of the FDA submissions of new drug applications and abbreviated new drug submissions. So what are the different processes can be validated? Identification test, quantitative test for impurity contents, limit test for control of impurities, quantitative test for the active moiety of drug substance, drug product or selected components in the drug, dissolution testing and determination of particle size. So depending upon the nature of the analytical processes, the validation procedure will be changed. So according to the different regulatory bodies, nothing but USP, ICH and FDA reviewer guidance, the method validation parameters are described as specificity, accuracy, precision, ruggedness, detection limit, quantification limit, linearity and range, and robustness. So when you compare the USP, ICH and FDA, the minimum parameters are specificity, accuracy, precision, ruggedness, LOD, LOQ, linearity, range, and robustness. If you see the table, the variation in USP and ICH is that only USP speaks about the ruggedness and precision, whereas ICH, it goes for the precision, repeatability, and intermediate precision. When you go for the FDA guidances, it also asks us about the reproducibility of the method. In next continuous sessions, we'll see what are the different parameters, how we are going to validate. So depending upon the method and type of the method for the intended purpose, the method validation requirements will vary from purpose to use, purpose of intended use. If you see the analytical table, accuracy, precision, repeatability, specificity, LOD, LOTU, linearity, and range, these are the common parameters described by the different regulatory bodies. And for the testing purpose, for the identification of a drug, you require only the specificity parameter. For impurity testing, the impurity testing is of two types. One is quantitative and other one is limit test. For quantitative purpose, you need to validate the method with all the parameters except LOD, that is nothing but limit of detection. And when you are going for the limit test, you need to perform only limit test for LOD and LOQ, nothing but minimum quantity where it can be detected and minimum quantity where it can be quantified. When you go for the procedure of assay, nothing but you want to estimate the potency and purity, you need to perform all the method parameters except LOD and LOQ. Now we'll see each parameter in detail. First of all, specificity. Specificity, as per ICH, the definition is, specificity is ability of an analytical method to measure the analyte free from interference due to other components. Nothing but see, when you are going for the drug substances, only your pure API will be there, analyte active substance will be there. But when you go for the formulated compounds, nothing but tablets, injections, emulsions, suspensions, there will be other excipients which are present along with your active form. So specificity describes, identifies the main compound, nothing but specifically it will detect your compound, nothing but your main active peak. The selectivity describes, nothing but specificity and selectivity both are same. Selectivity describes the ability of analytical method to differentiate varied substances in sample, nothing but your excipients or any other antioxidants and active forms. So the specificity can be in chromatographic method, the specificity and selectivity can be done to demonstrate the resolution, nothing but if you have different excipients and active substances which are coeluting at each other, to demonstrate that active peak can be differentiated from the excipient, you need to demonstrate the resolution, nothing but the differences in your chromatographic retention times. Second, the selective specificity can be done in two ways. First is when the impure, for assay purpose, you will be directly checking whether the active substance, there is any interference from the other compounds at the retention time of active substance. But when it comes to related substances, the method validation specificity parameter will be done in two ways. First one is where the impurity or degradants are available. Second one is where impurities are not available. In specificity, plays a major role in the validation parameter during the related substances method, which ensures the quality of the product. Nowadays, the guidances are very strict to ability of the method to identify where the all the degradant products and process related products and even the metabolites can be detected up to the LOQ level, nothing up to the reporting thresholds. ICH describes the related substances in reporting thresholds, identification threshold, and qualification threshold. Reporting threshold is nothing but where up to the minimum level where your reporting of the impurities need to be done. So from the either from the 0.05% or 0.1% of your active moiety. So in specificity, you need to give the assurance that the compound, nothing but the degradant or process related impurity, can be detected from the reporting threshold value, nothing but there is 0.1%. If you are not going to show any specificity parameter in your validation, then you cannot describe your method as a stability indicating, because your degradants as well as the impurities may elute at one retention time. So to demonstrate the specificity, first of all, when the impurities are available, you need to spike all the impurities and degradants at a specification level, nothing but your identification level or qualification level. So you're at the specification level, you need to demonstrate the specificity by spiking all the impurities and showing that they are not eluting at each retention time and they are free from the interference. Second one is show resolution and lack of interference, nothing but when you have 10 to 12 degradants or process related impurities in a one compound, so to verify your method as well as to give the assurance of the method that the whatever the product you are going to test, it will be of a quality and safety issues, free from the safety. So then you need to show the resolution between the impurities as well as the active peak and lack of interference from the other excipients. So as specificity, you are going to perform by spiking all the impurities on your active peak as well as all the excipients, nothing but other matrices of the formulation, and you will be showing that there is no interference from your excipient peak and there is no coevolution of the other degradants at each other retention time. The second method is when there are no impurities are available, the new compounds or new chemical entities where the degradants or impurities isolation is not possible, you can show the specificity by conducting a forced degradation study. Nothing but your active substance as well as the formulation matrices, you are going to stress forcibly by using the environmental factor, nothing but temperature, chemically hydrolysis, acid hydrolysis, base hydrolysis, oxidation, light stress, nothing but its photostability, and the metal degradation. Nothing but you are going to add one of the heavy metal to your compound and see whether the compound is degrading or not. So these are all the forced degradation studies will give you the ability of the compound to withstand to other chemical entities as well as the environmental factors, as well as describes the method in future, nothing but your self life, what are all the other impurities that may elute, that may come from your compound. So during the specificity, you will be performing both forced degradation study as well as the spiking the impurities on the formulation matrix, because the method whatever you are going to use will be used to describe the self life of your compound. So in future there may be new impurities or new degradants which may be formed upon the stability of the sample. So to prove that your analytical method can detect all the impurities and degradants from the active moiety, the forced degradation study will help you in doing that and give the assurance that the method is capable of detecting all the other impurities as well as the degradants. So when you perform the forced degradation studies, what are the outcomes you may get? First of all is the peak purity. Peak purity is nothing but it is a way the main peak, active peak purity will be checked against if any other degradation products are coeluting at the same retention time. The peak purity of 0.99 is essential to describe your compound, whichever it is eluting at that retention time, is free from other impurities. Second one is mass balance. Mass balance is nothing but when you go for the quality testing of the products, you will be performing the purity as well as the potency testing, nothing but your assay and RS. So when there is a decrease in the active moiety, the other degradants and the other degradants will be formed in the related substances. So you'll be matching your assay results along with the related substance, other degradation compounds, which should be close to your 100% of the mass balance. Nothing but if there is a decrease in 2% of the active moiety, that 2% should be reflected in your related substances method. Because now the guidances, FDA and EMA, they are very strict that even the compound, the mass balance of 99.99 is achievable, and they are looking even a 0.1% of the impurity should be detected in your method. And from the forced degradation study, like I said, during the stability of the product on storage, the degradation pathways can be known and the degradation products can be identified in your method. Second parameter is linearity. Linearity is nothing but the ability of an assay to elicit a direct and proportional response to changes in the analytical concentration. Nothing but the direct proportionality between your concentration as well as the response in your method. For proving an linearity, you need to have at least minimum of 5 concentrations. You can go for the 7 or 9 concentrations depending upon the type of the procedure you are following, nothing but assay RS. So linearity will be evaluated by visual inspections of plot signals, nothing but your response as well as the concentration you can directly visualize, or nothing but using the statistical methods, linear regression, correlation coefficient, y-intercept, slope. So see, this is the linearity plot where you are seeing on the x-axis there is a concentration and on y-axis there is a peak area. The regression line, the straight line, indicates the linearity of the method. Nothing but the whatever the concentration you have injected, that is the peak response you have got. If there is an, if the regression line is not straight, that indicates that your method is not linear and that is a non-linear method, which is not acceptable. For the regression line, the correlation coefficient should be at least 0.999 for the assay and RS, and depending upon the other residual substance, nothing but GC, when you are going for the estimation of the solvents, other test, the regression correlation coefficient will change. Any any guidance will give you only how the method can be validated. It, the different parameters will depends upon the product characteristics and the purpose of the analytical method for which you have been, you have developed the method. So the acceptance criteria will change depend upon the product characteristics and the purpose of the use. In all the guidances, it only gives you how, what are the different parameters you need to establish to complete the method validation, and it gives you the only the pathway, and it is up to the individual depending upon the method development as well as the product characteristics and the purpose of the method for reporting the quality of the product. You need to give the other parameters, nothing but your acceptance criteria. The third parameter is accuracy. In any analytical method validation, precision, linearity, as accuracy and specificity plays a major, these are the four parameters which plays a major role. Accuracy is nothing but closest of the test results obtained by the method to the true value. Nothing but if your true value is around 90 and the test results you are obtaining about 95, 97, then that is not an accurate method. True value is nothing but if there is a compound which has a purity of 90%, then your true value should be close to 90. If it has 100%, then it should be close to 100. So accuracy should be established across the specified range of an analytical procedure. Specified range is nothing but when you are going to go for the method validation, or nothing but for establishment of an validation parameter in the analytical method. First of all, you need to check what is the concentration of the analyte I'm going to test. Depending upon the analytical test concentration, you will fix a range from where your method will be linear and precise. For example, if you have taken an analytical concentration of 1 mg per ml, so range should be assessed based upon the type of the analytical method you are validating. If you are going for the assay method validation, the range should be at least from 80% to 120% of your test concentration. And for the related substances, depending upon the specification level, nothing but your ICH reporting levels, your range should be from 0.1% or 0.05% up to the 2% or 5% based upon the highest impurity specification level of your test concentration. If your impurity specification is around 2%, then you need to validate the method accuracy from 0.1% to 150% of your test specification. Nothing but your specification is 2%. So 150% of 2% is around 3%. So you need to set a minimum of 0.1% to 3% range for the accuracy studies of your product. So the accuracy should be studied in at least 3 minimum concentrations and in triplicate, each in triplicate. So total 9 determinations should be done. So there is a minimum 3 concentrations and each in triplicate. So based upon your specification level, you can go for the up to 5 or 7 levels or 7 different concentrations, but it should be done in triplicate. So in accuracy, what will be known? Accuracy, the percentage recovery of the known amount of added, or the difference between the mean assay results and the accepted value. See, nothing but see, accuracy is nothing but to how much amount of the true value we are getting from the method. Nothing but see, I have a compound where it is 100% potency, purity is there. Is my test method is giving the 100% true value or not? So what will be done? Accuracy is tested by spiking a known amount of this sample, nothing but your pure active compound or impurities, whatever you are going to test, on the formulation matrix. And you will be calculating the percentage recovery, nothing but how much amount of the compound you have added and how much amount you have been recovered. Amount added and amount recovery is very much important here. Amount recovery by amount added into 100 gives you the percentage recovery, nothing but how much amount of the compound you have recovered from the formulation matrix. See, accuracy describes, accuracy importance is that when you are when you have gone for the validation of the formulation matrices, nothing but suspensions, emulsions. So there, the extraction of the impurity or the degradant product from the formulation matrix is very much important there. It gives you the sample preparation techniques. It depends upon the sample preparation techniques as well as the sample matrix, because your formulation is composed of a different chemical entities. So each chemical entity will have different responses. When you go for the other polymers, if you are using any polymers in your formulation, that may bind your impurities, and the impurity level, whatever you are showing in the product compound, is very less. Nothing but your chromatogram, whatever it is showing, is very less, because the polymer has binded to the impurity. So for this purpose, accuracy, what it does is that it will give you the result where your method is suitable for the quality testing or not. Is your any of the ingredients, nothing but your active moiety or any impurity, is binding to your formulation matrix or not? So accuracy should be done at least using 3 concentrations and in triplicate. Next thing is precision. Precision is nothing but the closeness of agreement, nothing but degree of scatter between the series of measurements obtained from the multiple sampling of the same homogeneous mixture. Sample, nothing, homogeneous sample is nothing but a single sample where the formulation matrix is made up of a single, all using a single formulation matrices. The precision, according to the, if you go for the ICH and USP, the precision is nothing but precision, and intermediate precision is described in ICH as well as along with the repeatability. For USP, you have only the repeatability and intermediate precision. See, repeatability, intermediate precision, reproducibility, they are correlate to each other. One by one, we'll see that. Repeatability is nothing but expresses the precision under the same operating conditions over a short interval of time. See, and minimum of 6 determinations at 100% level. 100% level is nothing but your target concentration. In analytical method, you are going to give your target concentration. That target concentration will be taken, and it will be 6 determinations, nothing but 6 preparations of the individual sampling need to be done to establish the repeatability of the method. And over a, see, if you see the repeatability, intermediate precision, as well as the reproducibility, the differences are that repeatability is nothing but a short interval of time, is nothing but during a 2 to 3 hours, nothing but depending upon the runtime, continuously you are going to run the 6 samples and you will establish the repeatability. When it comes to intermediate precision is nothing but they express within laboratory variations. Nothing but laboratory variations are nothing but different analysts, different systems, different days, nothing but different environmental conditions. So it gives you the intermediate precision. So intermediate precision is nothing but expressed within laboratory variations, expressed in terms of standard deviation, relative standard deviation, and confidence interval. See, standard deviation, RSD, and confidence interval are nothing but the statistical tools what we are going to use in the analytical method validation to interpret the results of the validation. So you have performed the validation, you have got the results, but how you will interpret the results, up to what instance they are right, and how much confidence you have on your results. So that will be provided by your statistical tools. In the later part of the session, we'll go for the statistical tools, whatever we are going to use in the analytical method validations. Reproducibility is nothing but ability to reproduce within the predefined precision. Nothing but, see, if you have seen, the reproducibility is nothing but in a short interval of time. Interval precision is nothing but where you are going to perform different variations, nothing but different within a lab, different persons, different analysts, different equipments. Reproducibility is nothing but, see, if you are going to perform that analytical method, you are going to run the analytical method for 3-4 days, it should give the same result. If an analyte is giving the different results on 3 different days, it is nothing but your method is not reproducible. So to check the reproducibility, we'll perform the precision on 2-3 different days and check whether the method is reproducible or not. See, if you take the examples on statistical analysis and precision data, reproducibility at 2 different labs. See, we have performed a precision on 2 different days on 2 different labs. So how we are going to establish a closeness between them? How we are going to interpret the data? So it depends upon your statistical tool, mean, standard deviation, and percentage RSD. Depending upon the statistical tools, you are going to measure whether your method is reproducible, repeatable, or not. So if you see this, we have prepared the 6 sample preparations, we have got the assay results on 2 different days. That is the same homogeneous mixture, nothing but the same same molecule, which have been tested on 2 different days. So if you see the mean results, on day one, you got 100.6, and day two, you got 100.1. So what is the variation is there? How can you identify whether the two results, whatever 2 different days results are there, they are right or wrong? So you'll be performing your statistical tools and check whether your percentage RSD. Percentage RSD here is 0.3% and 0.6%. For each parameter, you are going to check the percentage statistical limitations, whether your method is right or wrong. Nothing but right or wrong is nothing but your method is performing well or not. So percentage RSD for the assay will be keeping around 1.5 to 2% depending upon the product. And for the related substances, where you are going to estimate the compounds from 0.1% of your test concentration, there up to 5 to 10% depending upon the product characteristics. And if you go for the residual solvents by GC, you will be having around 15 to 20% of the percentage RSD. The reproducibility and repeatability depends upon many parameters. See, whatever we have said, studies should include a varying days analyst equipment, because see, varying days is nothing but day-to-day variation you will be coming across. Analyst is nothing but your whatever the method you have developed today, they may be used at along the globe by different laboratories and different analysts. Okay, so whoever the analyst is performing the method or analysis, he should get the accurate results, as well as the equipment. What is the importance of equipment is nothing but, see, each equipment will have the different precision and accuracy. So your method capability is also dependent upon the equipment, whatever you are going to use. So that's why for the precision, you are going to use different equipments, different analysts, because on day one, I have used the equipment where its percentage RSD is only 0.1%, nothing but your reproducibility is 0.1%. Next day, I have used another equipment where the percentage of RSD of that equipment is around 3%. 0.1% and 3%, they will not correlate. So what happens there is that the same compound will give you 2 different results. One day you are going to get around 0.5%. Next day, because the minimum repeatability of the equipment is 3%, you may get around 2.5 or 3% or 3.5%. So the variation is very high there. So to get the reproducible result and to show your method is reproducible and repeatable, you need to perform the precision, internal precision and reproducibility on 2 different days, minimum of 2 different days and 2 different labs. Here, along with the precision, if you go for the initial slide, whatever we have seen here, ruggedness is nothing but one new term what we have seen. In FDA guidance, you have intermediate precision, reproducibility. Ruggedness, USP is ruggedness. Ruggedness is nothing but the reproducibility. In later part of the session, we'll see what is ruggedness is. Ruggedness is nothing but your reproducibility of the method. See, if you see this, there are 4 different diagrams are available. First one is that, see, Precision is nothing but the scattering of degree of scattering of your true scattering of degree of scattering. Nothing but if you see the black spots, they are scattered on three on different ways. The center part is nothing but your true value. Only the one preparation, nothing but your one preparation is at the true value, and different results are scattered throughout the diagram. It's nothing but your low accuracy and low precision, because the compound is not meeting its true value, and the compound six preparations what you have prepared have different results. When it comes to your second value, nothing but low accuracy and high precision. See, your true value is in the middle, but the degree of scattering of the compound is on the left hand side. Nothing but all they are at together, nothing but they are showing the good precision, but they are not having any accurate results. Nothing but they are away from the true value. If you come to the third one here, the high accuracy and low precision, nothing but the sample preparations, the results whatever you have got, they have the high accuracy, nothing but they are close to the true value, but they are not scattered at a one place, so they are showing low precision. You are going to get the true results only when you have the high accuracy and high precision in your analytical method. Nothing but your all the preparations are near to your true value and they are scattered at one place. That gives you the high accuracy and high precision. The next parameter we are going to see is LOD and LOQ. Limit of detection and limit of quantification are used only for the estimations of the related compounds, nothing but the impurities and related substances, and for the limit test. Limit of detection is nothing but the lowest amount of analyte in a sample that can be detected, but that are not necessarily quantified. Nothing but you can detect the compound, but you cannot quantify. Nothing but you cannot say that at least this much amount of the percentage of the impurity or compound is present. LOQ is nothing but the lowest amount of the analyte in a sample that can be quantified with suitable accuracy and precision. Nothing but in detection, you don't have any accurate and precision values. At detection limit, you will not get the precision and accuracy. So you cannot report the impurity values from the LOD. LOQ is nothing but where the quantification limit at a limit where the method is accurate as well as the precise. Nothing but your true value will be 100%. The LOD and LOQ can be established in different ways. The LOD and LOQ are estimated based upon the visual evaluation, based upon the signal to noise ratio, and based upon the standard deviation of the response and the slope. Nothing but while performing your linearity, you will be performing the linearity for assay, you will be performing from 50 to 150%. But when it comes to your related substances, you need to perform your accuracy and linearity from your LOQ levels, nothing but your reporting qualifications. Whatever the according to ICH, they have given the reporting qualification. If your reporting qualification is 0.1%, you need to show the linearity from the 0.1% to your 150% of your specification level. The limit of quantification is at least that should be a 0.1% in your method. So when you establish the linearity from the regression line, we'll calculate the slope as well as the standard deviation, and we'll calculate the LOD and LOQ. First of all, based upon the visual evaluation, nothing but whether you can quantify the visual evaluations is nothing but when you are going for the limit test. Limit tests are nothing but by perform based upon the changes in color, right? So you are going to use any other compound and verify whether there is a color change or not, and up to what extent you can identify the color change. That is called as an detection limit. And the prominence, nothing but significant color change, is called as your limit of quantification by visual evaluation. Based upon the signal to noise ratio, signal to noise ratio can be calculated nowadays. All the instruments, they are calculating the signal to noise ratio directly. So for the limit of detection, at least you need to have a signal to noise ratio of 3, and for the LOQ, limit of quantification, your signal to noise ratio is 10. This LOQ LOD will be useful for reporting of your impurities, nothing but which are present at the low level at 0.05% or 0.1% of your levels. So when you are developing a method, you need to check your LOQ, minimum LOQ value should be above the reporting threshold, reporting thresholds. Nothing but if your reporting threshold is 0.1%, your limit of quantification should be at least 0.05%, and limit of detection is around 0.01%. And third is based upon the standard deviation of the response. Nothing but from the linearity. In the linearity, you are going to establish the slope, intercept. From there, you are going to take the slope of the calibration curve and the standard deviation of the blank readings. Nothing but blank readings are nothing but, see, before you are going to go for the HPLC analysis, you are going to inject the blank. So based upon the blank noise, nothing but the noise whichever has been generated from the system by the method should be calculated. Based upon that, you will have the LOD and LOQ values. The establishment of LOD and LOQ value, LOD and LOQ values are trial and error process, because you don't know up to what extent the method is suitable or up to what quantification limit the method is suitable. So here you are going to run on the trial and error process and establish what is the LOD and LOD and LOQ of the compounds. Next one is robustness. Robustness is nothing but the capacity to remain unaffected by the small but deliberate variations in method parameters. So if you take the example of HPLC, you are going to have the mobile phase. Mobile phase, there might be a pH in the mobile phase, buffers, as well as the organic solvents present in the mobile phase. Second is that, so why the robustness is important is here is that while performing the analytical method, you are going to prepare the mobile phase, you are going to use the different HPLC columns, you are going to use the different HPLC systems on day-to-day routine testing. So there may be small changes, they are not deliberate, they are not intentional, but there may be a small changes in the mixing of the mobile phases or lot-to-lot changes in the column lots, as well as the different variations in the systems. So to account to the account of that, we'll be performing the robustness by using different mobile phase, pH mobile phase. See, we are going to take the, if you are studying the pH of 3 in the mobile phase, you need to generate a robustness based upon the 0.2% units of the 0.2 units of pH. Nothing but if you are using a pH meter, my pH meter may give, I want to give the mobile phase of pH 3, adjust the pH to 3. Due to the calibration standards, I may get around 2.99. The true value you are going to see is only 3, but there may be 2.98 based upon the instrument performance. So to account that variations, we are going to perform the robustness. Robustness will be performed on pH of the mobile phase composition, nothing but the different organic solvents you are going to use, and columns, temperature, flow rate. These are all depend upon this very small variations will give us the method robustness. Nothing but if I'm perform, different analysts will perform, prepare the mobile phase in different ways. And they are going to use different measuring cylinders, pipettes for the preparation, nothing but different solvents. So depending upon the potency of that solvents, there should not be any change in the results of the compound in your analytical method. To prove that, you will be performing the robustness. So for performing the robustnesses, you need to show at least 0.2% variation in your pH of the mobile phase, 5 to 10% change in your organic phase, and 2 to 3 different column lots. Temperature is nothing but column 1 temperature. In HPLC, you will be using the temperature. So you need to change the temperature plus or 5 degrees and check whether your analytical method is robust or not. Flow rate, nothing but if you are using any 1 ml, 1.5 ml flow rate, you need to change your flow rate 0.2 units. Nothing but if you are using 1, change it to 0.8 and 1.2 and check whether your method is giving the reliable results or not. Ruggedness. See, ruggedness is nothing but the degree of reproducibility of the test results under variety of conditions. Nothing but variety of conditions is nothing but different laboratories, different analysts, different instruments, different reagents, and different days. See, your analytical method, whatever you are validating, it should give a reviewer 100% confidence that whatever your method is there, it is true and the quality of the product can be tested by using these methods. Because all the data, whatever you have generated in routine analysis, that will be used for the submissions of your new drug applications and ANDAs. If your method is not suitable and if your method is not true and it is not giving the true results, then how the reviewer will accept that whatever the results you have submitted, nothing but your assay, RS, identification is true. So all your method capability will be tested in analytical method validation, and it gives the reviewer assurance that the whatever the method they have used, we have used for the testing of the compound, is true and it is giving the quality results. Quality results is nothing but a true results, up to 100% accurate. Analytical method validations, how we are going to interpret whether your precision is right, you have achieved your internal precision, you have achieved the linearity. So there are some different tools we are going to use your analytical method validation to interpret whether the method is capable and can be used for the intended purposes. So in statistical tools, we are going to evaluate first mean. Mean is nothing but the average of data set calculating by adding all data points and dividing the sum by the number of samples. See, mean we are going to use in the precision. You are going to test 6 different samples and you are going to evaluate the differences between each preparation. So you are going to have, the mean is calculated by adding all the 6 precision values and then dividing it by the total number of the samples. Nothing but if you are using 6 samples, that will be your denominator, and whatever the sum of 6 sample results will be on the numerator, which will give you the mean. Standard deviation. Standard deviation is nothing but measure of the spread of values in the sample set and is computed by measuring the difference between the mean and the individual values. See, in 6 preparations, there will be variations from each preparation to preparation. So in combining all 6 preparations, what is the major variation what we have got? See, one, we may got 1 or 2% result. In second, we may get 98%. So there is a 4% variation in the result. So when you compute all the 6 results, you will get the standard deviation. The least the standard deviation is, more precise your method is. Relative standard deviation. Relative standard deviation is calculated by standard deviation sample set. See, standard deviation is sample set, deviation of the sample set multiplied by 100 and dividing it by sample set average. Nothing but your standard deviation by nothing but divided by your mean average results into 100 will give you the percentage RSD. Percentage RSD will give the method variations. How lower the percentage RSD, higher the precise and accurate the results are. Higher precise your method is. So percentage RSD should be below. That's why for the assay, we will keep only 2%, because your active moiety should not vary more than 2%. And for the related compounds, related substances, for calculating your impurities, degradant compounds, will keep the percentage RSD below 10 or below 10, nothing but 10 or 5, depending upon the compound in your method validation. Confidence interval. Confidence interval is nothing but indicates the limit around the sample mean to predict the range of true population of the mean. See, confidence interval, according to your guidance, it will be calculated at 95% level. It gives the minimum and a maximum value from your true value. You have performed the precision, you will be getting the 6 values. So one will be mean, nothing but one will be less and one will be high. So your mean value, mean percentage RSD, it will pass, but the 95% confidence interval will give the reviewer assurance that if you are going to apply that method, your test results may differ from ±2% or ±3% of the true values. Regression analysis is nothing but you evaluate the linear relationship between your test results. This will be used in your linearity, where the linear relationship between your concentration as well as the response will be calculated. The residual sum of squares is nothing but the variability in the response that accounted by the regression line. In linearity, you are going to linearity will be performed by injecting either 5 different concentrations or 7 different concentrations, and all the concentrations should be linear. If any one of the concentration is not linear, then it will be shown in your regression line, and there will be changes in the residual sum of squares. Residual nothing but there will be variability in your residual sum of squares and the linearity. You will not get the point if your all the components or all the concentrations whatever you have injected has given the linear results, then your correlation coefficient will be 0.999. If any one of the compound is concentration is deviating, then your regression line will come down and your correlation coefficient will be around 0.95, 0.97 depending upon the results. So residual sum of squares is nothing but the square. You will be calculating the variability in that regression line. How much variability is there? 0.97, 0.99 is okay. But how much the variability is there in the true value? Next is intercept. Intercept is nothing but the value of y when x is equals to 0. You are going to extrapolate your linear correlation coefficient values and calculate the intercept. Slope is nothing but slope of is the line related to relationship between the concentration and responses. Nothing but here slope will gives you the linear relationships between your concentration as well as the response, from which you can calculate your limit of detection, limit of quantification. Analysis of variance. See, analysis of variance is nothing but when you are going to perform the precision, internal precision, repeatability using a single homogeneous sample. How much variation is there in 3 different parameters? In precision, you are going to perform only 6 preparations. In intermediate precision, you are going to prepare 6 more samples of the same homogeneous mixture. And in reproducibility, you are going to perform the 6 sample preparations in different laboratory conditions by different analysts. So you are going to correlate all the 8 preparations of the precision on 3 different days, nothing but, and you are going to check what is the variance of the compounds are there. The method validation significance is that whenever you are going to submit your data to the FDA reviewer, the FDA reviewer will check out the, first of all, the analytical method validation, how the method validation has been performed and for what purpose the method validation has been performed. Because if your method validation statistical analysis does not give the confidence that your method is capable of separating all the determined compounds and you can identify, quantify your active peak, then only the reviewer will accept your results. So method validations, when you go through different guidelines in the method validations, they give only the glimpses how the method can be validated and what are the different method parameters can be used for the validation purpose. No guidance will give you or a procedure or a analytical or a methodology you need to perform the validation in this way. Nothing but the in each individual compound, nothing but formulation, depending upon the formulation matrices, depending upon the chemical attributes, the method parameters will be same, but acceptance criteria will be different. Nothing but the interpretations will be different. So before performing the method validation, so what are the requirements you need to be, there should be there for performing a method validation? First of all, a protocol. Protocol is nothing but you will be giving a document evidence that my method should be validated by using these parameters, nothing but your accuracy, precision, these are all common parameters. But how each parameter should be evaluated? Linearity, how many concentrations I am evaluating? Precision, how many preparations I am preparing? 6 preparations are according to your guidance. But to increase the confidence of the method, how many preparations I may incorporate in the protocol? So protocol will give you the protocol is prepared to give the analyst a pathway for the performing the method validation as well as the predefined acceptance criteria. Predefined acceptance criteria are nothing but precision, linearity, whatever you are evaluating, there should be a predefined acceptance criteria. Precision, my precision is around 2%. during the method development only, I will check what is the precision level I'm getting. So based upon that, I will predefine my acceptance criteria. And the standard, detailed standard test methods. Detailed standard test methods are nothing but what are the different equipments you are going to use and standards you are going to use, samples, as well as the chemical reagents. See, validation, analytical method variations will depend mostly upon the variations will occur because of the chemical reagents. Each reagent will have individual potencies, nothing but your purities. Depending upon the purity, your method redundancy will be varied because each chemical will have different purity. Nothing but if you are using a potassium dihydrogen phosphate to prepare a buffer, if it is 100% pure, then you will get the equal molality. But if you are using a chemical substantial grade, nothing but your 80% or 90% pure, then your molality will vary, which will result, which will impact on your method as well as the results what you are going to repeat. So in detail, you are in protocol, you are going to keep all the standard parameters, nothing but how the sample is prepared, how the standard is prepared, in what way the sample is prepared. So you'll keep all the individual parameters in detailed way. Third one is report, documented results. Nothing but while when you're performing the method validation, each and every parameter should be documented. In as per the GMP, the rule is that whatever you do, you need to document. Whatever you document, you need to do it. Nothing but it should go, whatever you have documented, nothing but whatever you have documented in the protocol, that should be performed and that the results should be reported. Second one, the last one is justification when non-pharmacopeial methods are employed. Nothing but see, for the new chemical entities, you will be developing a method in in-house laboratories. So that methods validations you need to justify, because if any compendial methods are available for an NH compound, already there is a method in USP, EP. If you are deviating from that method, you need to give a justification why you have changed the method. If any compendial method are there, you need to follow that compendial method as per USP and EP. If you are not following, then you need to justify why you have changed the pharmacopeial method. Nothing but because of change in any formulation matrix or any other parameters, you have changed the method. That justification you need to be given to the FDA reviewer. Thank you.
Thank you, Srikanth Garu.
Hello. Yes, sir.
Thank you. Thank you, Srikanth Garu.
Thank you, sir.
Your presentation is precise and accurate.
Thank you, sir.
And there are many compliments from the viewers, like nice presentation. Please share your PowerPoint and thank you for the webinar presentation. And there are many more other adjectives like excellent. So we are thankful for your time and sharing your knowledge with our students and viewers who have joined this particular international presentation webinars. Almost many countries have participated, sir. From US participants are there, and from across the many states of this India also, many students are present. And we are thankful for your presentation having many valuable points like validation as per US FDA, ICH and USP guidelines. Because there is a table which is giving a very clear guideline to the students. What are the differences between various regulatory bodies as far as the analytical expectations are concerned while submitting the regulatory clearances. Especially between the major regulatory bodies like US FDA, ICH and USP, and why this validation is necessary, and what are the validation of compendial procedures, what kind of compendial procedures have to be followed in the company while going for validations, and impurities, what are different types of impurities present during the forced degradations such as the temperature or hydrolysis and acid-base hydrolysis, oxidations, etc. Even during the storage or even while undergoing certain kinds of accelerated stability studies. So you have covered almost a voluminous content in a nutshell, and I hope all our students and viewers have benefited with your presentation, sir. Now I request Vice Principal and Head of the Department of our college, Dr. Professor A.Srinath Madam, to there are many questions also from the viewers, at least a few, three, four questions we request you to answer to the listeners for their encouragement. Later we will also share your, with your permission, we'll share your email ID to the viewers so that they will be in touch with you to enrich their knowledge or to clarify their doubts in this presentation, whatever they have. And thank you very much. And I request Professor A.Srinath Madam to take over the session.
Yeah, sir. I'm going to conduct a questionnaire session.
Okay.
Before that, let me introduce myself. I'm Professor Sunita, Vice Principal, and expert in analytical method validation. My specialization is analysis, sir. I have 20 years experience in the same field. Published more than 60 papers. I'm glad to hear you, sir, today. I'm very happy to be part of this session. You have given a clear cluster coverage on analytical method validation. I felt so happy. And covered why do we validate, when method validation is required, what are the compendial methods and non-compendial methods for verifying the parameters, and what is the differentiation between the USD, ICH, and FDA guidelines. Sir, you have clearly stated the differentiation between the reproducibility, repeatability, and intermediate precision also. I hope the participants have gained so much knowledge on the analytical method validation. We have received so many questions, sir. Out of that, we are going to ask a few questions to clarify their doubts. With your permission, the first question is, when do we prefer partial validation and fully validation parameters? Is there any specification?
Yes. Partial validation will be performed at a development stage where the data, we are not going to submit it to the any FDA regulatory bodies.
Okay.
Two validations you are going to perform when you are going for the execution stage of your project, where your method will be used to test the quality of the product for the submission purpose, nothing but for the FDA general bodies and guidances, you are going to submit your stability results and for the marketing of the compounds. So whatever the methods you are going to use for the submission purposes, as well as the marketing products, you need to go for the full validations. And at the laboratory stage, where you are in the initial designing of the product, there you can go for the full partial validation of the method to evaluate whatever the results you are getting are accurate.
Very nice, sir. There is another question from the audience side. That is, in the case of formulations, by recording only blank standard and test chromatograms, can we state that the method is more specific?
No. When you are performing the specificity for the formulations, you need to show the placebo interference also, nothing but the other matrices interferences. Because in related substances, you are going to evaluate different impurities as well as the degradation products. So the responses of the matrices will definitely interfere your impurities, and there will be more from your blank. So if you want to show the specificity, you need to inject the other formulation matrix also to differentiate between the placebo peaks, nothing but your formulation matrix peaks, as well as the impurity peaks.
So I request all the participants kindly note down this important point. So without injecting the plasma or without performing a placebo chromatograms and impurity studies, we cannot give the statement the method is more specificity. Am I right, sir?
Yes.
But and usually, generally,
one more clause is there. According to the guidances, if you are not going to able to prove the specificity, then you need to justify your method along with the supporting second analytical method.
Okay. But usually while referring the reputed journals, many of them are publishing in that they simply mentioning by recording blank standard and test chromatogram, the method is more specificity. So
no regulatory body will accept the method. See, for the assay purpose, it is okay. But for the reporting of your related substances, impurities, the specificity is very 100% required. And in the initial slide, you have seen for the guidances have given a clear indication on what are the different parameters you need to show based upon the test procedure. So if you are using any identification test, specificity may not be required. So depending upon the test procedure, the specificity requirement is used. But for the related compounds, the formulation matrix is very much important.
Yeah, without placebo, we cannot perform the specificity studies. Very good, sir. Then another question is, what is the acceptance criteria for robustness parameters of by deliberately we are changing?
Yes, deliberately we are going to change the method parameter. In robustness, you are going to compare the results of your precision with your robustness results. And you will be establishing a percentage RSD variation between your varying analytical method against your normal method. So that percentage RSD should be below, if you are going to use any assay method, it should be below 2. And if you are using any related substances, you will be verifying your relative RRT is nothing but relative retention times as well as the precision. So you need to compare your robustness results against the precision results obtained from the precision. Because
by
the whole analytical method validation, you are going to use a single homogeneous sample.
Okay, that's good.
You cannot use two to three different samples in a method validation. So a single sample will be used in all the parameters. So in robustness, whatever the results you'll get, you will compare it with the precision and you will statistically interpret what is the variation between your robustness and precision values.
So we need to measure the peak area and calculate the percentage RSD.
Percentage RSD and then compare with your precision values.
Okay. Good, sir. Nice. And then another question. Why ruggedness is not considered in ICH guidelines recently?
Ruggedness is nothing but the variations in the different laboratories.
Yes, sir. Hmm.
Okay. So ICH will not give you about the ruggedness. It will give you about the reproducibility of the method.
Yeah.
Okay. So as per the guidances, whatever you study is different. When it comes to the industrial level, all the methods, whatever you have been validated, it will be transferred to some H laboratories. So that is will be covered under your method transfers, different variations in your laboratories.
Yeah.
Ruggedness will be performed, but it will be it's a method transfer.
Another question, sir. When do we suggest to go for ANOVA test?
Analysis of variance will be, see, when you are going for the method transfers, you will be validating method in an H laboratory. Then you are going to transfer your method to the Y laboratory. So in both laboratories, this single homogeneous mixture sample should be used and you'll be comparing both results of the both laboratories. And so the variation will be calculated there.
Mm-hmm. For accepting the method or for what purpose?
For accepting the method.
Okay.
You have validated, complete validation has been done in one lab.
Yeah,
so you are transferring to the another lab. In method transfer, you will be performing only precision, specificity, only minimum parameters.
Mm-hmm.
So to evaluate the results, evaluate the trueness of the method, you will be calculating the variations in your assay, variations in your impurity reportings, and specify whether the method is transferred or not, depending upon the ANOVA.
Okay. And last question, sir. While developing the method, only few parameters were validated. The values are not correlating. So then what is the suggestion you are going to give, whether we have to changing the method or again have to put a much more concentration on validation studies?
During the partial validation, if there is any variations in the nothing but any results, then yeah. You need to root cause analysis. You need to do the root cause analysis and check at what point the method parameter there is a variation in the results. There may be because of the change in concentration or diluent or repeatability of the column. So there will be n number of factors which will be affecting your partial results of your partial validation. So in initial development, we will do the backward root cause analysis and verify where the method is causing a problem. So we will rectify it and then we'll go for the full validation.
Yeah, maybe due to nature of the drug, sometimes it may happen.
You can't say about the nature of the drug substance. There are other factors, nothing but your repeatability of your columns, lot-to-lot okay. variation in the columns, or mm-hmm. any due to reproducibility issues, or any solubility issues, or extraction of the compound from the formulation matrix. So there may be n number of factors. So you can't mm-hmm. directly correlate about the nature of the drug substance. You'll be verifying each and step backwards and verify where the method is causing an issue.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Thank you
so much for sparing your valuable time with us, and you have given a very clear-cut answers to the participants who are attending for the today's session. Now I request program convener, Dr. M.V. Nagabhushanam Garu, to propose vote of thanks.
Srinath Garu.
Yes, sir.
Good evening, sir.
Good evening, sir.
Our senior-most faculty member, Sitarame Garu, who has his previous experience in CDSCO also, and also offered his services as drugs inspector and various other countries. Sir wants to wish you and sir wants to have a clarification about some points. Okay, I am just requesting you to listen and answer to the Sitarame Garu.
Yes,
Sitarame Garu, please.
Hello.
Good
afternoon, sir.
Good afternoon, sir.
Thank you very much for your valuable lecture. We are happy to listen to you. So my just small question is, similar to drugs, whether the government of India has notified various laboratories for testing these medical devices, or they want only send these samples to the same drug testing laboratories which are there in CDL Calcutta, CIPL, Ghaziabad, and other state laboratories. Since it is in the beginning in our country, I would like to know if you have some information about these facilities for the testing laboratories for the medical devices.
Testing of the medical devices.
Yes. One is at the manufacturer's level, you do test. You see that they comply with the requirements. If the government wants to verify whether they are complying with the Medical Supplies Act, government has started or yet to start any temporary arrangements made for the time being?
I don't have any information regarding that.
Okay.
Because medical devices, we are going to use the medical devices here for the development of some products, nothing but pre-filled syringes.
Right.
So medical devices testing is a separate department.
Okay.
Which will be taken over by the packaging department.
Okay, sir. Okay, thank you very much.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, good evening, dear all participants. So we are going to conclude the third day of PRAJWALA, the international webinar series session today, which is giving a great knowledge on contemporary issues in pharmaceutical regulatory affairs to the participants, with the participation and elaborately giving the details of the pharmaceutical regulatory expectations and analytical regulatory expectations by the experts who are working in various departments of the pharmaceutical industry, including our Department of Pharmaceutical Regulatory Affairs. And all listeners are very much thankful for sparing their valuable time and sharing their knowledge with all of us. So I believe that the session given by the sir today has given an extremely useful information to all of us on the regulatory issues given by the ICH and the FDA with respect to the analytical aspects. And we have learned a great deal and very much indebted to the speaker, who has discussed in detail about various regulatory aspects in pharmaceutical analytical procedures. And I, on behalf of the Department of Pharmaceutical Regulatory Affairs, Hindu College of Pharmacy, and also on the special guests who are present in the audience, and also on my own behalf, our heartfelt thanks to the speaker, Srinath Garu, for accepting and educating all of us on this particular session. And I wish to extend my thanks to the management heads of the Leutis Pharmaceuticals for their encouragement, which benefited us with the extraordinary speaker. And it's my privilege to thank our management of our college, Sri Jubudi Rangaraj Garu, chairman, and secretary and correspondent, Dr. A.S. Madhusudan Rao Garu, the principal, Dr. R. Govindrajan Garu, and the vice principal and head of the Department of Pharmaceutical Analysis, Professor A. Sunita Garu, and OSD Sitaramai Garu, for joining us in this particular session. And my vote of thanks is also extended to all the students and participants who made this particular session a great success. Thank you very much for all of you. And tomorrow morning at 9 o'clock, we will meet again. Today, we are ending this session, sir. Thank you.
The 10 rules of GMP. Confirm you are trained and have correct written instructions before starting any job. Follow the instructions exactly as given to you. Always report errors and bad practices immediately. Ensure you have the right materials before you start a job. Use the correct equipment for the job, confirm its status and cleanliness. Maintain good segregation. Protect against contamination. Work accurately, precisely, and methodically. Maintain good standards of cleanliness and tidiness. Ensure that the changes are pre-approved through the change control system. Never assume anything. Before performing any task, check it out. The 10 rules of